Good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2022. For the first item on our agenda today, we are continuing to take evidence for our college regionalisation inquiry. During today's session, we will take evidence from trade unions representing teaching and support staff at colleges and from an organisation which supports student engagement in the quality of the learning experience, to hear the views of staff and students on the college sector and the impacts of regionalisation. I would like to welcome Stuart Brown, who is the National Officer from the Educational Institute of Scotland. Good morning. Eve Lewis, the Director of Student Partnership in Quality Scotland, or SPARKS. And Lorcan Mullen, the Regional Officer, Head of Higher and Further Education from Unison Scotland. Good morning to all of you. A bit of housekeeping to begin with. Our session is hybrid today, with our witnesses and one of our members participating virtually. So can I ask those that are attending remotely, as you won't be able to catch my eye, that if you want to come in, can you put a capital R in the chat box when you wish to speak? And the clerks will be monitoring the chat box and I will bring you in when I can. And also, I want to reassure you that it isn't necessary for every witness to respond to every question. So if you don't think that you have anything to add on a particular question, that is fine. However, again, should you wish to speak, please pop an R in the chat function. The Q&A session will last for approximately an hour this morning, and I would like to thank you all for your time today. So, with that, can I go to our virtual colleague, Mr. Mundell, Oliver Mundell, for the first question, please?
Thank you, Convener. It's almost impossible to talk about the college sector without talking about funding. I find it hard to believe that off the back of the pandemic and from a government that talks up opportunities for young people and learners in Scotland, that we've seen the college sector so badly funded. And I'd just be interested to hear your views on the impact this has had across the country.
Will we go just from an alphabetical point of view? Can we go to Stuart Brown from the EIS first to respond to that?
Thank you, Convener. Yes, EIS, FILA, the part of the EIS that organises in the college sector, will always want more funding for FE because FE has a specific mission within Scottish society. It works to provide opportunities for people that have perhaps been left behind by other parts of the education system or are retraining. And we're often told that FE has a pivotal role in the post-COVID recovery. So any cuts in funding or any perception that there is a lack of funding is obviously of concern to us. We would always want more funding for FE. We've got a very important mission to achieve for Scotland. And the outlook over the next couple of years looks pretty grim. It is of concern. I know of a number of colleges that are already looking at pretty serious cuts, including some colleges that are considering compulsory redundancies, which is obviously of a concern to our members. So the sector as a whole has some serious challenges in regards to funding moving forward.
Thank you, thank you, Mr. Brown. Ms. Lewis, Eve, do you have something you wish to contribute?
Yes, I suppose in relation to funding, colleges do such an amazing job in terms of access to education, routes into different types of work and into higher education. Students get so many life chances from the college sector that funding of colleges is vital. In relation particularly to the area that I work in, I suppose one of the current pressures of funding is in terms of the ability of students' associations to operate and represent student voices effectively. And we're currently seeing already quite precarious organisations being affected by cuts to funding and cuts within colleges, so the staff support and areas supporting students' associations. So that's of a worry for us.
Thank you very much, Eve. Lorcan Mullen, over to yourself now.
Thanks, convener. So, yeah, I echo the comments made by Stuart Brown. I think there are very difficult choices for the Scottish Government at the moment in terms of budget, but we've been on record for years saying the further education sector is chronically underfunded. The information that we have, and I think this is from a bit of research done by College of Scotland, is that per place there's lower funding for college students than any other element of Scottish education, so lower than nursery, primary, secondary and university. And especially if we think about the demographics within Scottish life that tend to access education through colleges rather than through universities, we don't think it's fair or equitable for that to be the case. Unison would support a step change in funding for the sector. The only caveat we would put on that is the sector still has choices with the funding that it has. So even if there isn't an improved situation around funding, we believe the sector could do an awful lot better in terms of embedding fair work, building a constructive relationship with the trade unions, and I think making some wiser choices in some cases. But we're only here today to talk about the sector, I suppose, in more general terms. So that would be the broad answer from Unison Scotland.
Thank you to the panel. Oliver, do you have a follow-on question from anything you've heard?
I also wanted to ask about the kind of position for colleges operating in more rural and remote parts of the country, and whether the representatives feel that those colleges were getting a fair deal, and whether young people and learners and those returning to education in more rural and remote parts of the country were getting a good quality service under the current model.
So perhaps on that, as it's about students and learners, can we go to Eve Lewis to respond to that first, please?
Yeah, I mean, it's not really within my expertise in terms of the funding models, and I mean, our approach would be students in every part of Scotland deserve the best experience, and that there needs to be models in place to make sure that that works in every institution, every college, and ensuring that we look at personalised approaches depending on where students are, where they're studying, what modes of study they do. I suppose some of the approaches in terms of digitalisation and how we can access students can access learning digitally, need investment in so that they develop sufficiently as well.
Thank you. I'll just go around because I'm not getting any R's in the chat bar, so I don't know if that means nobody wants to respond to the questions further, but perhaps I can go to Mr. Brown, if he's possible.
Thank you, convener. I think part of my answer to this question is maybe a reflection on the regionalisation process. Regionalisation led to a number of college mergers, with a number of colleges becoming significantly larger entities. And one of the concerns that the EIS has had throughout the process of regionalisation and now presently is the impact that's had on equity of access. So where colleges before may have been smaller entities embedded in the local communities, they are now part of larger entities, where perhaps someone in a town or a rural area may have to travel further to access a course. And that is a concern because as I'm sure the committee know, rural poverty is an issue in Scotland. I live in the northeast of Scotland. I taught in the northeast of Scotland. I'm fully aware of the effects of rural poverty. And if you all of a sudden have to travel maybe 50 miles to access a course you used to be able to access on your doorstep, I think that is a serious concern, because there will be some individuals, some students that cannot access the education that they need there. In terms of the sector more generally, I think regionalisation, as I said, created some large entities. Those larger entities tend to be urban-based, and it's certainly the perception of the EIS that some of those more larger urban colleges have a slightly different perspective of the future of the sector, looking towards tertiary models and degree awarding and things like that. which would risk, I think, leaving rural communities further behind in terms of equity of access. So that is a big issue that I think the sector must grapple with in the next couple of years.
Okay, thank you very much. Oliver, anything further?
No, I'm happy with that, Convener.
Thank you very much. So the next suite of questions is from my colleague Ruth. Over to you, Ruth.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Obviously, colleges do provide that important access to education and routes to employment, as you've said this morning. I wonder if the panel can share their reflections on how colleges post-regionalisation are responding to the needs of learners and the needs of the communities that they serve. Stuart, you spoke a little bit about it there. I wonder if I can come to you first, and just to, it'd be good to hear some of the good practice as well as the challenges, if possible.
Sure. I'm going to apologise to the committee. It seems there's a gardener outside with a very loud piece of equipment, so apologies if that is causing a bit of feedback. I'll try to use my teacher voice and project over it. As I said, regionalisation created larger entities across Scotland in terms of college mergers, and I think there are competing visions. There are certainly colleges out there that are very community-focused, and I know that from working and speaking with principals and managers and union reps in those colleges. And there are other colleges that perhaps see the future of the sector in a slightly different way, looking at competing with post-92 universities, etc. And I think that of those two options, it's the latter that concerns me more, and it is the former that I think really is the mission of colleges. So there is good practice in the sector. There are colleges out there in rural communities that work very closely with their local economies, but also understand that they've got a societal importance as well. It's not just about the needs of business, it's about the needs of the society and the community that they're in. And I think that's something that the EIS would welcome more encouragement on the sector to focus on, not just the needs of local businesses, but the needs of local communities. And I think in more rural areas, that becomes even more pertinent.
OK, thanks, Convener. If I can go to Eve now.
I suppose in terms of how colleges respond to the needs of learners and how they is around how they approach and listen to those student those learner needs. So within the regional colleges, there's been a big improvement in terms of the ways in which colleges listen to and respond to. They've got much more active students' associations that operate at a regional level, and I think often really getting to the nuts and bolts of what's working for students and what's not working for students. When we ask students about whether they want more localization or of courses or more spread out across the region, their answers are diverse. So some want some local stuff, some want a development of a more expert course in one location, and some are very willing to access it remotely, whereas others have real access problems. So things like childcare, disabilities will all have a play on whether or not people can access a course locally or across a region. So I think there's been lots of excellent work across and in regional settings meet the needs of students, but there's some difficult choices that people need to make, and they need to make sure that students are a key part of that decision making to make sure that it happens in their best interest.
Convener, through yourself, Eve, if I could just press you for an example of some of that good practice. It's good to hear exactly what that looks like for a student, obviously acknowledging that it'll be different, you know, the diversity of needs of the students. But if you could share with the committee some examples of what that good practice would look like.
I think the good practice in terms of how colleges work with their student body and make decisions in partnership with them. So where colleges are reviewing what's happening and their provision strategically with students and with the Students Association, that helps them make good decisions. And remember very early on, for instance, within one of the colleges, that's quite urban based, there was an assumption that you could easily move courses and have them in one location. But it was the students that were able to point out some of the challenges, even within an urban setting, of a student dropping off their children at school and then getting on a bus and getting on another bus and getting to the other location. But also now some of those things are changing. So there's huge numbers of students that like some of the digital provision, and there's huge numbers of students that don't like the digital provision. So there's a really important way of working with students to make the most of, so digital provision could help a parent dropping off someone at childcare and then having to get into a course. But also it can also be a barrier to learning as well. So it's really important to understand the complexity of the student experience before you make decisions about where you put courses.
Thank you. And Convener, if I could hear from Lorcan as well, please.
Of course.
Thanks, Convener. So speaking honestly, the trade union experience is always going to skew more towards the poor practice, the negative examples, because that tends to be where we're called in. There certainly is good practice out there, but if we're looking at regionalisation, and if we're looking at where some of the practice has been a bit more problematic, the fact that regionalisation has been coterminous with years of recurrent cuts and recurrent severance programmes, it means that within, say, a college spread across a local authority area, you may have services now concentrated just on one campus. You may have had, you know, staff cut in certain areas, so it takes longer to access those services, either in terms of waiting times or in terms of travel and transport. And our concern is that that's a diminished level of service, and it's more stress and more difficulty for the staff that are delivering those types of service. So, say, bursary, student finance, learning support, etc., etc. So, we think that would be the sort of the underlying structural reason why so many of our members in different surveys have reported growing levels of stress and work intensification since the start of regionalisation. Those different issues coming together. So, apologies, I don't really have good examples to bring you, but those are the examples that in broad terms that I can give you when we've received feedback from our representatives and members in the sector.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Brown wants to come back in, I think, on that point as well, if that's possible, before we move on.
Thank you, Convener. It was actually to pick up on Eve's point of digital delivery, because I think there is, and I'm sure we can all understand, a massive amount of potential in digital delivery. Over the course of the pandemic, the College Lecture and Workforce, our members really stood up and delivered in terms of digital delivery. I'm not saying that that is an answer to all problems of access. I think there are some serious issues potentially in terms of access with poverty, but it was just to make the point that some scoping out of the pros and cons, the successes and failures of digital delivery would be something I think across the sector that we would welcome. Indeed, it is something that through the NGNC we have requested that the sector engage in. However, as of yet, college employers have not taken us up on that offer.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. And Lorcan, I think you want to come back in again as well.
Thanks, Convener. So just very briefly on that digital point, I mean, our union is not against innovation, it's not against a greater use of digital tools within education, and obviously there was great work done during the pandemic to maximise the student experience using those tools in difficult circumstances. But we think, and we would say this in universities as well, the type of sort of rich campus life, that community experience, that's crucial for students. And within the current budget context, with the pressures on colleges, there are some college management teams that are making assumptions about a move towards a more digital delivery model, making assumptions about what the permanent situation will be after the pandemic in terms of the number of people on campus, and they're using that to remove crucial services, whether that's nursery, whether that's the provision of good food on campus, and all of those things are negative for the student experience. They diminish the student experience, and they leave college students in a worse position than university students, for example. So we don't think that that's just, we don't think that's equal. So that would be our word of warning around, sweeping ideas of a move towards digital, that we don't lose that crucial element of student life and that crucial element of learning.
Thank you very much for that, Lauren. And I think Ruth's got one more. Yep.
Yes, thank you, Convener. I suppose just the thinking about that responsiveness to communities and to business as well for Roots to Work. How much influence does staff have on the choice and design of the qualifications that colleges are offering? If I can put that to Stuart Brown, Convener.
I think that's a good question. I would say, in all honesty, that it would be inconsistent at best. One of the things that regionalisation has caused that is of major concern to the EIS is around college governance and our perception that college principals and management teams have significant levels of power over decision making without an awful lot of what we can see proper accountability to their college boards. So there are colleges out there that are more collegiate towards the unions, but I wouldn't believe, or I don't believe, that that is the culture across the sector. EIS FILA has an education subcommittee of its executive. Our members are not just trade unionists, they're educationalists. The EIS in the school sector is engaged in all sorts of different fora in terms of educational policies, designing curriculum, these sorts of things. That does not happen to the same extent in the college sector, and I speak from experience on that matter. It is something that we would like to see more of, because when you're designing the curriculum, when you're designing your educational provision, having the practitioner's voice in there is pivotal. So I think the fact that that is inconsistent at best is of major concern.
Eve, I notice you've got an R in the chat bar. Is that to respond to that one?
No, it was the previous question, so I'm happy to move on.
Okay. You
content, thank you.
Thank you. And thank you very much for those questions. And CoCab, over to yourself now.
Thank you, Convener. I've listened with great interest to the contributions so far. I want to sort of drill a little bit more into sort of like the transition stages and how colleges communicate with schools to make sure that our young people know the options that are available. And then I'll go on to talk about, well, maybe you could talk about the bit between colleges and universities as well. So I suppose my first question would be, I think I'll go for Eve first, and then possibly Lorcan can come in, and Stuart, if you've got anything to add. How effective are schools in highlighting the options that are available in colleges? Eve?
I suppose I would comment from the start that over the period of regionalisation, there's been amazing work in colleges to reach out to schools and to reach out to universities. So there's in those 10 years, the growth of programmes where colleges are dealing with school pupils, bringing them into the college for teaching or going out and doing provision within college has transformed, and equally the growth of articulation routes. I see amazing practice every day where we're looking at these routes in and out of college and into other things like apprentices as well, I think, in terms of into workplace, and a big growth in those types of. I think there are some areas where that works at a regional level as well in terms of planning. I think there's some very good examples of colleges and schools planning together and colleges and universities doing some planning together, but it maybe needs more input or more activity to nurture that joint planning across the sector. And currently I'm doing quite a lot within the quality processes to looking at the student journey with a tertiary approach, so that instead of just looking at what the college does or what the university does or what the school is doing, that we look at the student journey and try and change the way that we look at routes and look at routes, look at the quality of the experience as well as the volume of people coming in and out and doing different routes. But there's still masses to do, so there's still plenty of young people studying in schools that do not know the options that are available to them in college and in university, and there's still massive issues around parity of esteem. There's some college routes that would be amazing for young people, but parents or other people involved in decision making perhaps negating those against other routes. And students themselves, definitely student perceptions of what college life will be like compared to what university life will be like, for instance, that might make them make choices that that aren't built on the full picture of information. But there are amazing practices still on pathways within some of the regions. There are some regions that have done some great work on looking at those pathways, but there's more to do.
You mentioned that the further activity that would be required. Can you give me an example? Have you got an idea of what that activity could be? Because, you know, we're in a position to make recommendations, so it'd be good to hear your ideas.
Okay, I think we could benefit from having programmes of work that really look at developing student, getting the student opinion, getting student voice through those routes. But the moment we do work listening to students in college or listening to students in university or listening to students in school, not all of those conversations join up. So if we look at some of the articulation routes or some of the journeys that students take, we could do some really amazing work, I think, at trying to look at what's worked and what's not worked and what has influenced their decisions, and trying to do work joining up those conversations from a student perspective. Quite a lot of the work at the moment is looking at targets and numbers, like making sure we've got the right numbers of students going through particular routes. But we could do more to look at the experience and what influences students' decisions, but not just talking to school pupils about their decision, actually going through to the people that have gone past that. So looking at the college or the university students and talking about how with hindsight those decisions have suited them, and then them also talking to the school pupils about that, those decisions and things as well. So, and also within that, making sure that staff leading courses, I think there's people involved in access and articulation routes and things like that that sometimes get together. But we have people at course design level teachers. So the idea of getting teachers, college staff, university staff with the students that are on those journeys and really having a good think about what's working and what's not working and how we can improve it.
Thanks, Eve. Lorcan, would you like to come in?
Lorcan said he didn't have anything to contribute, so if we can move on to Mr. Brown to respond.
Brilliant. Okay. Thank you, Convener. Yeah.
Thank you, Convener. I think this is a really, really interesting question. We all know the importance of transition at every stage of the educational journey of people. That goes from Mali 1, going from nursery to primary 1 in August, right through to people going to college, people going to university. I've got a couple of points on this. I think, again, and Eve's maybe touched on this, and I think Eve's answer to this question was really interesting. I think, again, it would maybe be inconsistent across the sector in terms of the quality of transition work, the quality of school-college engagement. And again, I think that is a sort of example of, certainly from our view, a lack of strategic discussion going on at sectoral level, at national level. There is a strategic partnership forum set up now that has both Lorcan and I sit on that forum. There's student representation on it, but it is in its infancy, and it's came 6-7 years down the line since regionalisation. It should have really been there since the start. I think there is a lack of practitioner voice in discussions around this, and I think that more strategic discussion about things such as transition would be welcome. I'm not saying that the EIS would look for a uniformity in how colleges do this. That is absolutely not what we're looking for. But it's about the sharing of good practice, ensuring that the practitioners and the students have a voice, and ensuring that whether you are in the northeast of Scotland or you are in the borders, you're getting a similar quality of experience, maybe not the same experience with transition, but a similar quality. So I think that is something the sector really needs to work on moving forward.
Mm-hmm. Thanks for that. So I suppose we've talked a little bit about how school courses dovetail with college courses. How do teaching staff in colleges support this transition? I think Eve mentioned a wee bit about it, but if there's anything further to add from the other contributors, that would be great to hear.
Perhaps, Stuart, if you can help with that.
Thank you, convener. There's varied ways that they do. A lot of colleges have what are called school-college partnerships, where college staff and school staff are involved in jointly delivering qualifications. However, EIS FELA does have some concern about the delivery of school-college partnerships. We're actually in the middle of an engagement in terms of trying to get as much information as we can about them. There are issues such as college lecturers who are perhaps not GTCS registered, maybe teaching in schools unaccompanied going on in colleges. We're aware of that. We're trying to find a bigger picture to see if we can get some answers around that. So there is an awful lot of work that goes on. Whether or not that it's completely student focused and not focused on, I think you've mentioned numbers and performance indicators, I couldn't possibly say definitely in either way, but the fact that I can't give you a definitive answer on that is a concern enough for me.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, convener.
That's super. And we've got a bit of change of tack now as we're going to move to some questions from Ross Greer.
Thank you, convener. In the first instance, I've got a couple of questions for Stuart and the IS. Your written briefing was very useful. I mean, it indicated that as far as FELA is concerned, the structures of the NGNC work well, and there are more issues, for example, in the individual college board governance. I mean, are you suggesting that the sustained industrial action that we've seen in seven of the last 8 years is largely being caused by issues elsewhere, i.e. with individual college principals or boards, rather than with any structural problems in the NGNC itself?
That's a big question, Mr. Greer. I'll try to answer it as best as I can. I think there are a number of factors in play here. As you said, in the submission that the EIS gave to the committee, I've made clear that we think that the NGNC is, on paper and constitutionally, a strong collective bargaining framework. I say that as the NGNC Union Side Joint Secretary. There is no reason, in terms of the structure, from what we can see, why that shouldn't work. Now, collective bargaining should encourage, force, cajole, whatever way you want to look at it, employers and unions into working more collaboratively. And it should actually, in my view certainly, stop industrial action happening. If you look in the schools, the SNCT has existed for decades, and school teachers have been on strike once since the 1980s. That is the power of collective bargaining. It forces collegiality and helps employers and unions work together. That has not been the experience of the NGNC. We're in the middle of balloting on this year's pay award. There were 8 days of industrial action in that campaign, 8 days in which our members lost strike pay, or lost pay through strike. And there has only been one occasion in the lifetime of the NGNC in which a pay award has been made without industrial action, and I think that is a concern of itself. So I think there is a culture, or certainly my perception is that there is a culture amongst college management that nothing gets given away for free, that it is adversarial, and there seems to be a misunderstanding is that trade unions react. We react to the employers that are in front of us. And if employers are adversarial, if employers are not negotiating in good faith, then we will react accordingly. And that is what's happened in the sector. Alongside that culture, there has also been situations where perhaps individual college principals have caused issues, or individual colleges have caused issues that have went national. I know that you're aware of what happened at Forth Valley College last year, where 27 lecturers had their contracts terminated and were re-employed on terms and conditions that to us were the same as a lecturer but paid significantly less, and were losing their class contact and things like that. That decision was reversed after a period of industrial action with no financial or educational gain to the sector. So, all in all, I think there is a framework there with national bargaining that is really effective on paper that should work. However, I have heard from the employer side of the NGNC different members of it at different times saying it is not the role of national collective bargaining to interfere in the local. That is not true. If you have national collective bargaining, your terms and conditions are negotiated nationally. So it is absolutely the role of the NGNC to have a view on things that are happening locally. So there's probably a lot I could say about that, Mr Greer, but I hope that's a good answer for a start.
I've got Lorcan wanting to respond as well, Ross, if that's possible.
Yeah, please do, Lorcan. Thanks. Thanks, Convener.
Well, thanks, Convener. So just something to add on behalf of the support staff unions and just echo on some of the points that Stuart made. I don't think there are major structural or constitutional things that need to be corrected with the NGNC. I think it's really more about cohesive buy-in from the employers on that side. And I'm hoping coming out, or as we emerge from the pay disputes that we're in at the moment, hopefully there's small steps towards that improving that I'm hoping that we can consolidate going forward. But Stuart's right. You know, we organise across many different sectors in Scottish society. We're not in dispute or battling for industrial action as often. In those other parts of Scottish public services, there's something particular to FE. I don't think it's the structures as they're written down. I think it's just the fact that there are some powerful figures in the employer side that have never really reconciled themselves to national bargaining, and that has different ways of articulating itself through the approach to the difficult issues, including disputes. And I think we can, with a bit of creativity and a bit of effort and a bit of intensive work on the employer side and to some extent on our side, we can improve things going forward. But it's been challenging, and I think some of the deep unhappiness of the staff's experience through regionalisation has played into this as well, in terms of stress, in terms of work intensification. That has a way of articulating itself through union structures as well, and I think that's part of the picture that can't be missed.
Thanks very much. I've heard suggestions from elsewhere that there are essentially interpersonal issues on the NGNC, that it's largely the same group of people who've sat on either side of the table for too long, and that's built up personal challenges that are maybe contributing towards these tensions. But from what you both said this morning, it doesn't sound from your perspective like that's necessarily the case, and the issues are perhaps more further upstream on the employer's side. I mean, Stuart, would it be correct to characterise your position that essentially NGNC negotiations work well, there's not necessarily profound interpersonal issues there? The challenges are when the employer side negotiators go back to the employers association to get ratification of whatever agreement has been struck in the room.
I think there's a lot in that, Mr Greer. So I'm not going to say that there aren't interpersonal issues in the NGNC. However, what I will say is this, is that I'm a relative newcomer to it. I've been in this role 18 months. And did not come from sort of adversarial trade union background from the schools. So I've came into it with an open mind and seen where I think the issues lie. There are some interpersonal issues. However, when you have had year-on-year disputes, 7 in the last 8 years, that is going to have some residue bad feeling, a residue lack of trust. That has been identified in 3 lessons learned exercises by the Scottish Government, but it hasn't. Those lessons learned exercises have not produced any change in the culture, any change in that element. I think there are structural issues in terms of how now College Employers Scotland, as they've rebranded, operate. And it is very clear to me, certainly, and to EIS FILA negotiators, that there are often times, in this pay situation that we've been in for the last 8 months is an example of this, where their negotiators do not have an awful lot of room to manoeuvre. Now, if you cannot come to a meeting with more than one position, you're not going to be able to negotiate effectively. The problem is that they have to go back to the College Employers Scotland, the college principals, and take direction. They also have to go back and get any agreement ratified. We saw this last year in the instructor assessor dispute. We reached an agreement in the room that was then turned over by the College Employers Scotland, and further industrial action happened after that that was wholly unnecessary. The way I understand the College Employers Association to work is that they need unanimity. in how they agree things. And that goes back to my earlier point about perhaps a disproportionate amount of power, influence, strategically and politically, between certain big colleges. Because if you've got a situation where one college principal can hold out and stop an agreement being ratified, that means that negotiations as a whole will suffer. So I think the structural issues, from our perspective, are not the machinery. It's what goes on behind the machinery on the employer's side that is a significant factor in the issues that we experience.
Thank you, Ross. I'm afraid I'm looking at the time. And I'm, is that OK?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, thanks.
And I need to do a bit of a U-turn because I admitted Stephanie Callaghan's question. So we're going to seem like we're stepping back a bit. But sorry, Stephanie, over to you.
Thanks very much, Convener. And sorry if this seems like a little jump backwards here. Earlier on, talking about college student associations, Eve mentioned about the fact that students have quite a diverse range of views right across how they access courses digitally, where they are, etc. there as well. So clearly it's not a one-size-fits-all right across the student population there. So it seems to me that there's a real need for choices and options for students, that kind of personalisation, to improve their ability across the board to be able to sustain places. And I'm wondering, is this something that student associations are advocating on? So to Eve.
Over to you, Eve.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. I think students' associations and the student officers within them have a very high awareness of the diversity of the students that they're representing and the diversity of routes that they need. I think the student officers are able and equipped to do a lot of work working with colleges, working within colleges and also working at a national level, so that we can talk about some of the ways in which we develop that personalisation of learning. I think sometimes the potential of student officers and students' associations to be involved in that discussion isn't always realised. So sometimes colleges and perhaps the sector as a whole relies on feedback, so asks students what they think and does an awful lot within the college sector, huge amounts of work listening to students and gathering student opinion happens. But I think there are opportunities for more strategic discussion with the Students' Association and the student leaders, because these are not simple choices. We're not saying approving one course of action or another course of action. They're very complex. And we need to make sure that student associations, student leaders are equipped first to have the conversations with a wide range of students, but importantly, are in the right places when we're designing and thinking about the future. Semi-regionalisation improved student input into board level. Those students' associations sit at boards and are at that sort of level of decision making. But that's not really where this sort of design element happens. So making sure that we look at design and development and ideas, really creating an excellent student experience, needs to make sure that we develop more routes for the Students' Association to be in that. And then within the college sector, there's that aspiration that they need to be part of that discussion. They need to be part of the strategic conversation. But we need to ensure they have the capacity to do that. And several students' associations are struggling on that capacity. We have young, inexperienced student officers coming into position, and they need proper support within the college to provide the continuity, to allow them to operate autonomously. They need support for autonomous, to be able to challenge. I think students' associations need to be able to challenge and be able to work strategically with their institutions. Yeah.
Thanks, Eve. That's really interesting, because the other question that I did have there as well was about the management boards and about whether students' views are getting parity, whether they're actually influencing changes that are improving their experiences and improving their outcomes. But just to, I suppose, to kind of look at what you've said there as well, you've spoken about students being involved in those strategic discussions with college leaders as well there, and the fact that there needs to be a little bit more support around that for students that are perhaps inexperienced. So I'm just wondering, from your point of view, how would you say that we make that happen, that we get students involved in that design element to improve things?
So we need to support colleges. We need to support colleges to look at the role and to look at the boards, to look at what the role of student officers on board is. So I think there are definitely occasions where the student association is reporting on its activities to boards. So it's almost using the board as a accountability process for itself. And sometimes enjoying taking up that role, because they'll be going to board and selling what a great job that they're doing and talking about all, not really being empowered to get into the more strategic decision making. So there's a confusion, I think, over why they're at board and what their role there is, whether they're there as a service provider or whether they're there as a strategic decision maker. But there is also more work we as an organisation can do in terms of supporting colleges to think differently about the role of students within their process. There's work we can do within writing into our arrangements, so writing into how we deal with things like outcome agreements and quality arrangements and things like that, to ensure that the role of students in that is as a strategic change maker. And then I think we can create national forums for those discussions as well.
Lorcan and Stuart wanting to come in on this. So if we go to Lorcan first.
Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. Just a brief observation on this. Like, there's a crucial point there from Eve around student representatives needing autonomy as well as support and capacity to properly express the views. As students, an observation I would have from different very difficult processes where services were stripped out from colleges or where courses were cut and were of genuine controversy with the student body as well as with staff. The colleges put a significant amount of effort into managing student representatives during that time and put a significant amount of effort into isolating them from staff representatives. As a way of trying to, you know, broker consent and try to get these cuts through. And I think, considering student representatives, and I don't mean this at all to be patronising, I once did this myself many years ago, they are going to be inexperienced. They're going to be passing through in a short number of years. They need the support, but they also need the space to be able to articulate challenging positions to college managers, especially in those difficult circumstances. Or else their voice isn't getting heard, the voice of the students. So that's something Unison has certainly observed in some difficult circumstances in some colleges, and it's not something we would want to persist.
Thank you. Stuart, over to yourself now.
Thank you, Convener. Just very briefly, DIS would share the observation of Unison on the dynamic of student associations at colleges. They are on the payroll, as it were. And I think that a lot more could be done to support the excellent student representatives that are in the sector to be more independent, to feel more confident in their independence and be able to challenge and contribute strategically. Because I certainly the EIS has experienced similar to what Lorcan's outlined there. And just finally, I am aware through discussions with the NUS that there are a number of student associations and colleges right now that are facing cuts. So I think that as well is a concern at a time when we're talking about trying to increase student engagement strategically. Student associations should not be having their resources cut.
Eve's put a small R. Have you got another question, Stephanie? Or...
Yes, I do.
One quick one. Yep.
Okay. Thanks. I really do appreciate those comments there. Just one more as well about diversity. So I'm wondering, you know, across student representatives and boards and the college student associations as well, there, Is there a kind of other attempts to make sure that there's balance in that there? So there's balance relating to how many women there are, but minority ethnic groups, disabilities, etc. Thanks.
Go to Eve first, and perhaps you can pick up if you had anything from the last point as well. Thanks.
So there are several pieces of work that happen within colleges to increase the diversity of student voice. So we're looking at it in terms of at the lower level rep levels. So looking at how much diversity there is there, and then looking at how that diversity within those reps translates to higher level reps, and then how that relates to board. But I think there's about who is on board on the board. So it's who's elected into those positions, and there's work to do there, but also the support that the Students Association needs from the college to ensure that when those board members are also able to work with a huge amount of evidence that is from that diverse groups of students. And that does link back, I suppose, to the things that we've been saying around students' associations and colleges aren't properly funded, and they are funded at the will of the college. So there's a real issue in how that funding works and the support that the students' association gets in terms of from the college in terms of its autonomy. So an issue that's not been resolved in the 10 years of regionalisation is how students' associations are funded and how they develop that capacity. So many of the staff that support students' associations are college staff. And so when you're trying to help a students' association develop an autonomous voice, a member of staff that's supporting that is a often quite junior member of college staff. But they're the ones with the ability to support and help them develop that autonomous voice. And it creates very difficult situations. But we are working on the diversity of student reps. The student reps that we deal with that work on board are amazingly diverse, I think. So when we look at, I deal with student reps who are doing amazing work within their colleges and are also juggling little children. I mean, they come from HE courses, but FE courses as well. And there's been a big improvement, I think, in the regionalisation and the work that we've done with students' associations has increased the student capacity to work. And there's some amazing officers out there who are very diverse. They come with lots of different student experiences that bring richness to the representation that they do.
Thank you. And now we're going to move over to questions from Michael Mara, and then on from after Michael, it will be Mr. Bob Doris. Okay.
Thanks, Convener. It's been really useful evidence so far. I mean, obviously, we're trying to understand the impact of regionalisation and that reform process that we've gone through. And I think that the coverage of industrial relations, I think, is a particular issue of concern to me. But I know that colleagues have covered that already, given how regularly these issues recur. And some of the questions, I think, on structural issues are really important as well. I want to focus on outcomes for learners, if that's OK. Maybe Stuart Brown commented on issues about equity of access for the coming out of that reform process, perhaps in terms of the numbers of colleges reducing and an urban-rural divide. So the SFC annual report most recently said that on college performance for 2021 said that there was a 61.3% completion rate in terms of for students. The nearest comparable figure that I have for England from the Department of Education is 89.1%. So I just wondered if Stuart, in the first instance, if you had any idea as to the gap in terms of completion rates for qualifications and whether the structural issues that you identified might have any impact on that.
Thank you, Mr. Mara. That is a really concerning gap when we're talking, 20-odd% in terms of the gap there between England and Scotland. I'm surprised by that. I wasn't aware that it was that large. I had perhaps suspected there may be a gap. I think that there has to be a line drawn between that and the regionalisation process. Some of the issues I've outlined earlier in terms of equity of provision. There is a funding aspect to that. There is also, I think, questions to be asked around how funding that is given to the sector is used and what the priorities of the sector are in terms of delivery. Go back to my point about competing visions amongst colleges about what they're there for. I think in a time where if the outcomes are sitting at 61% of completion, any discussion about moving towards more tertiary education and more degree awarding powers and all these sorts of things, and that is part of the dialogue in some parts of the sector, that is really concerning, because there is going to be a significant amount of people that are, who are already left behind, getting further left behind. So that is of a concern. I think some of the governance issues, and I'm happy to answer further questions on my views on college governance, certainly come into the factor of this. And just sort of finally on that, educators and educational professionals need to be at the heart of designing curriculums, the heart of delivering outcomes. If there is a culture in the sector where their representation, the representatives, the trade unions, who are a professional association as well, are not engaged with effectively, then you're not going to get the best outcomes. We need to break down that barrier between the unions and management, and we need to get more inclusion of practitioners, more practitioner voice in the delivery of colleges, and away from a shift of simply numbers, key performance indicators and all of the rest.
Lorcan, any comments on the same issue?
I'm afraid that's a figure I've not seen before, Michael, so I don't think I can really comment on that, especially without checking with our committee just to see how that squares with their experience at the coalface. But obviously it's been very difficult through the pandemic years. That's not something that's unique to Scotland, but everything else that we've talked about in terms of, you know, recurrent severance programmes, cuts in staff and how that's been contiguous with regionalisation and potentially shuffling about to some of those reduced services within a local authority area and the effects that they may have. I suggest that none of that helps in terms of completion of courses. So I'm afraid I can't give a more detailed answer, not having seen that information before. Yeah. That's all
we need to make stage. A bit of progress here, looking at the time.
So my last question.
You better be a short supplementary today.
It's a question about the differences between large colleges and small colleges, which I think comes to the core of what we're actually here talking about. So these figures are unique to Scotland and are in the SFC report as well. The difference in completion rates for large colleges are 52.7% to 70%.
Short, please.
Well, I'll leave it, convener. Okay. Because if I can't give the figures...
It's the similar figures, I think, that we got last week, so, yeah.
I would have liked the response from... to me, it's a core question about the difference between large colleges and small colleges.
I did say short supplementary, so okay. Perhaps without... So I'm going to move on now to Mr Dorris, if that's OK.
OK. Thanks, Convener. My substantive questions to Mr Brown. I found the submission really helpful. I was particularly interested in how colleges coped through COVID. I know time's short, but we should put our thanks on record to the amazing work done in colleges. Some of that's reflected in the EIS Fela evidence, saying that colleges coped incredibly well. So there must be some strength within regionalisation that enabled colleges to cope well. But of more interest to me, Mr Brown, was that it was inconsistent. So what's key for this committee would be, how do we get that consistency across the regions? And then there was a concern in relation to that not happening nationally. So it's how we get that consistency across the regions and across colleges and make sure it happens nationally. I thought that was really interesting with the evidence.
So...
Okay, thank you, Mr Dorris. I would say that colleges succeeded because of the commitment of the people that work there. Our members, the members of the support staff unions, all the staff stood up and delivered. They were experiencing all the pressures that we were all experiencing during the early stages of the pandemic, and they adapted to new ways of working almost overnight and continued to deliver for students. And I think that is something that I need to put on the record, is how hard all college staff worked to achieve that. I think in the submission I've outlined some of our concerns about inconsistency, and that is linked to the lack of national discussion that took place. You had the CRG, the COVID Recovery Group, that was led by the government, which was good, but it was very, very high level. What didn't take place, despite many, many requests from all the unions organised and recognised in the sector, was sectoral level discussion. There was not really much in the way, if at all, discussion at NZNC about COVID matters. And when you're talking about issues like absence management, etc., due to COVID, that's a terms and conditions issue that should be discussed at NZNC. Health and safety matters can be contractual. That should have been discussed at NZNC. It never was. And we were met with resistance around that when we did bring it up. We have the Strategic Partnership Forum, as I said earlier. I think that's a step forward, but it's came very late in the day. And one of the things we've been pushing for, and we started during the darker months of the pandemic, was let's have a national health and safety forum. Let's get used to employers and unions discussing, sharing issues, sharing good practice to see if we can get that consistency across the sector and approach. And again, the employers have not taken us up on that offer. So there's been many attempts throughout the pandemic to try and get more consistency through strategic level discussion at a sectoral level. However, they have fallen on deaf ears with college employers throughout the period, unfortunately. And I think that is very, very disappointing.
Mr. Dorris?
Okay, thank you. I'll leave that particular one there. Can I have a brief follow-up question to Mr. Mullen, if that's okay? Mr. Mullen, you understandably spoke about what you thought were negatives within your submission. The paper we have in front of us shows massive increases in successful learners across a variety of groups, for adult returners, for disabled, for black minority ethnics, from people from deprived backgrounds, right through the regionalisation process, which is clearly, the figures are striking, Mr. Mullen. So I get that there's concerns for, the question's absolutely coming, Convener, there's concerns in relation to defending your members' interests, but surely you must accept there must be a strength somewhere within regionalisation, as imperfect as you may find it, that we've had this significant progress across all the groups we want to see succeed, and that's why FE is there, of course.
You direct that to Mr. Mullen. Mr. Mullen?
Yeah, there definitely are some benefits to regionalisation. There are some strengths, you know, some of the points that you've made there. Unison has no counter-argument to them, I suppose, and I said this in response to one of the earlier questions, our experience always skews more towards the negative, because that's when members call their trade union in, you know. So I don't disagree with anything that you said there, Mr. Dorris, but I suppose the issues around regionalisation, the way you're articulating, would be more to do with the problems rather than the benefits, because that's what our members bring to their reps bring to their officials, bring to their committees, and I suppose that's kind of our function, you know.
Bob?
I mean, Convener, I suppose the reason for asking the question to Mr. Mullen is absolutely defend members' interests, but we want you to be a proactive part of improving the sector, and to be proactive in improving the sector, you've got to identify the positives are and work collegiately to push on those positives, and is that something Unison's up for doing?
Oh, absolutely, and I think if you spoke to some of our senior representatives, one of the key reasons why they are seeking more facility time, on a par with what they've given some other sectors where industrial relations are better, to take the health service, is one example, that it would free them up to actually do a bit more of the forward-looking collegiate stuff, not just the fair fighting around the detrimental issues. So when time is short, they have to focus on, you know, the most urgent and pressing issues, and unfortunately those are where detriment falls on members, fighting back against that and trying to defend members' interests, as you said.
Any further questions?
Mr. Brown does want to come in, but sorry, for the purposes of the committee and timing, I know our next section is going to be quite concise, so I'm extending this section by 5-10 minutes, okay, to accommodate Mr. Brown's response to this and then questions from Mr. Rennie. So over to you, Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Convener. I'll be very, very brief. I think I'd just like to make clear that all the unions recognised in the sector do want to work with the employers, but it maybe relates slightly to my answer to Mr. Dorris's last question. That needs to be met by our employers. And I said earlier in my evidence that trade unions react. If we are continually in a cycle of confrontation, of dispute, of having to fight for pay, for having to fight for our terms and conditions, having to fight to defend national bargaining, that erodes trust. And I think a lot needs to be done to rebuild trust, because I do think there is a lot of worth to be found in collaborative work. So it was just to put that on there. And the final point I would make is that facility time across the sector is an issue. It is routinely a cut that is taken quite quickly by college managements. If you want proper union engagement, you need to give elected representatives, workplace representatives, the proper time to engage. Because if they don't have a lot of time, all they will deal with is the firefighting issues. They need to have time so they can get involved in the wider life of the college as well.
Thank you, Mr Brown. And then I'm going to move over to questions from Mr Rennie now.
It was just to say that I found EIS Fela's submission constructive.
Okay.
I didn't find it defensive. I want to put that on the record. Okay. We should also put on the record, convener, that we don't have comparable figures between Scotland and England for 2020-2021 completion rates, and that's twice our figures
been
put on the
Rennie,
record over 2 weeks, which we don't know if it's remotely robust, so we should put that on the record.
Mr Rennie.
Thanks very much, convener. I'm surprised by the evidence today. I mean, this sector has faced 10 years' worth of cuts. There's 43,000 full-time or whole-time equivalent student places cut. We've got a 51.9 million cut this academic year coming. We've got flat cash up until 2027. But you don't seem angry. And I'm really surprised why you're not angry. If I was you, I'd be spitting mad. Why is that not the case? Stuart Brown, perhaps, first.
Please don't confuse my politeness and deference to this committee as not having frustrations or indeed anger. Perhaps if I had been sitting in front of this committee 2 or 3 weeks ago, Mr Rennie, in the height of a dispute that was dragged out by the employers, I would be expressing my anger in more forthright terms. It is immensely frustrating trying to make progress in terms of employment relations in the sector, because it is often the case that we are met with opposition. I know the EIS Fela, their elected representatives, want to be further involved in the strategic life of the sector, the strategic decision-making of the sector, but progress is not made, and the anger is real. And the problem you have now is after 7 or 8 years of a cycle of disputes, trust is eroding between the unions and the employers, but also trust is eroding between our members, college staff members, and their management. And I have seen it on picket lines in 2 disputes now. I've seen it in conversations. There is an awful lot of anger in the sector from our members directed towards their management. They often do not feel valued. They often feel that they are perhaps the enemy to management at times. So that anger is there. And please don't confuse my politeness without a lack of anger there.
Well, you're a great diplomat. You've mentioned the management several times, but aren't you both just victims of government policy?
I don't think it is as simple as that. I think the Scottish Government does have a role to play in the sector, and we have seen in past disputes the Scottish Government stepping in to the sector. There have been 3 lessons learned exercises instigated by the Scottish Government, so attempts have been made. But it's the follow-through on those attempts that doesn't seem to be happening. Now, I can't understand, coming into the sector 18 months ago, why we are on the 3rd lessons learned exercise that is telling us pretty much the same things are the problems that the last 2 did. I think there needs to be a serious look at college governance. I think the issues of accountability between principals and their boards are something that has to be looked at parliamentary level and by the Scottish Government. Because, as I said earlier in my evidence, it is the view of the EIS that certain principals and certain colleges have disproportionate power and influence within the sector. And until you balance out that more equitably, I think we're always going to have these problems.
Other witnesses like to come in?
Lorcan's got an R in the chat bar.
Thanks, Convener. Thanks, Mr Rennie. So, I hope you've noted that I've emphasised funding, I think, in almost every answer that I've given, the need for a step change in funding for the sector, and I've cited the relative funding figures for the different stages of education within Scotland and about how colleges lag behind all of the other elements within that step. I think I'm angry all the time, Mr Rennie, in my work, and I sort of have to have a certain level of balance, or else you can't continue to operate. But there's huge frustration. There is anger amongst our representatives and within our union about that relative funding level compared to universities. When we're talking about services, just like a catering, for example, to be stripped out, to have colleges where people can't get a hot meal on the campus and it's just a vending machine instead, that's not the experience in most university campuses. And that's not to play one sector off against the other. That's absolutely not what we want to do. We also represent thousands of members in that sector too. But yeah, the funding desperately needs to be addressed for further education. It's something that we've been very clear on in our evidence, I think, and what we've said today. And I think what we just need to emphasise as well is there are still choices, there are responsibilities for sector leaders within the allocation that they're given, and that there's a lot that needs to improve there as well. So we're just trying to balance that out in the evidence that we give.
And Eve has put an R in the chat bar. This will be she can respond to Mr. Rennie. Thank you.
Yeah, I suppose I just want to make clear I'm not here from NUS, and I know NUS is would have a lot to say on the issue of funding. Certainly in the conversations that we have with students, that college funding is a long-term concern, and the way it affects the structures, but also the way it affects the student experience. And I suppose as I was saying right at the beginning, it is the part of the sector that plays such an important role in giving people life chances and changing approaches to education. And we do need to think about how we invest in it and how we give it the parity of esteem that it deserves. But certainly I would say you do need to speak to NUS and get input from them in terms of long-term funding and how they feel about it.
No, so thank you very much for your answers and responses today, and thank you very much for allowing us to extend the session ever so slightly. It was very valuable. I didn't want to cut things off too much. So I'd like to thank you for your time today, and we will now move on to agenda item 2. So I'll let you guys go. Thank you very much. Our next item of business is the consideration of 2 pieces of negative subordinate legislation. The Education Fees Scotland Regulations 2022, which is SSI 2022/156, and the Student Support Scotland Regulations 2022, which is SSI 2022/157. We will start with the Education Fees Scotland Regulations 2022, SSI 2022/156. So do any members have any comments on this instrument? Mr. Rennie.
Yeah, I have a constituency case convener of a Ukrainian student who's living here, you know, has been taken in by a family in North East Fife, but they're studying in Ukraine. They can't receive any universal credit support because they're classed as a student, and they can't receive any student support because they're studying in a Ukrainian university. And I'm just keen for us to perhaps, on the back of this, write to the Minister of the UK Government and of the Scottish Government for them to sort this out, make their mind up. Are these people students or are they ordinary citizens? One way or the other, they should get some kind of support. I suppose I don't mind which, as long as it's something, because we need to provide proper hospitality for them.
Thank you, Mr. Rennie. Does anyone else have anything to comment on that? No? And are we, if we are, as a committee, agreed to take up on the action that Mr. Rennie is suggesting, that we write to both governments to try and find a solution for these people? Yes? Agreed? Excellent. Thank you, Oliver, for acknowledging and I'm not hearing anything from Mr. Day. I know he's just listening in remotely. So the next, thank you very much for that. Next is the consideration of the Student Support Scotland Regulations 2022. And do members have any comments on this instrument? Not on this one, that's fine. So has the committee agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendations in relation to this instrument? Everyone's nodding. Thank you very much. That's super. That is the conclusion of the public part of today's meeting. We will now consider our final agenda item in private and can ask members that are attending virtually to reconvene on Microsoft Teams in a few minutes. Thank you and good morning.